No, he's sorry.
Oh my gosh.
They are well. The doctor who comes to us is now.
Just שלום.
שבת שלום.
שנה טובה.
שנה טובה.
חג שמח.
חג שמח. Hi everybody. Hi. שנה טובה. שנה טובה. So wonderful to see everybody. It's beautiful to have been here. I just said to Amy, it's so nice to now have been here in this shul for a few years, that when I see people, it's an automatic, you know, happiness to see people and love, and so it's really wonderful to be in this space with you all. Yes, Shana Tova. Let's start with a song.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Welcome everybody and Shana Tova.
Ah, we can, no. Shana Tova. Woo! Shana Tova, we have arrived.
This year I have Daphna to help correct certain wrong attitudes. I'll introduce Daphna in a minute, but before I want to say welcome to the new shul. I want to say welcome to Beinenu. I want to say welcome to guests who are here for the first time. I want to say welcome to people who are joining us virtually. Welcome to everybody. We're very happy to open this year with all of you. I'd like to begin by inviting my Dada Mama. Everybody should have a Dada Mama. And I am the only one I know in the world who actually has one. So I am very lucky. And I would like to invite Joni Heger Zosike to light our candles for Shabbat and Yom Tov.
Eloheinu mel
Melech HaOlam. Asher Kirshanu B'mitzvotav V'tzivanu Leha the first Shehechiyanu of the new year, in which we give thanks for the life we've lived, the life we've received, and for this moment of life that we get to experience right now.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher yitranu b'mitzvotav shehiyanu v'kimanu v'hiyanu la
Sovereign of all, who has kept us alive, sustained us, and brought us together for this season.
Amen.
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 So those opening blessings told us, especially that candle blessing, it told us that we are actually double lucky today. We get to celebrate both Shabbat and Yom Tov. It's the first Shabbat of the year, and it's also Rosh Hashanah. That's an extra blessing. And on Shabbat, especially at the new shul, we have a way of kind of looking back at the week. What went on this week, actually? Do I remember? No. But on this evening, we also remember, we have the opportunity to kind of go back to the whole year. So, what happened last September? Nobody knows. October, November. Oh, we got some. The trimitzvah happened in October. November, December, where were we in January, February, March, April, May, June, then there was this summer, right? And here we are. Here we are now. If we were a slightly more traditional shul, we would be saying the full Mizmor Shir Leyom HaShabbat, Psalm 92 in this moment, because it's both Shabbat and Yom Tov. And there's one line that I think we should take in for a second. Rob, yeah, there you go. You guys see it up there on the screen. Ma gadlu ma'asecha Adonai. Try that. Ma gadlu ma'asecha Adonai. Me'od amku machshevotecha. Me'od. So the first part, ma gadlu ma'asecha Adonai, means how great are your deeds, O God? How many things did you do? Right? You do things. I want to say that actually to all of you right now. You guys did so much this year. So many things. Every hour, every day, every week, every month. So much things that we all did. They were great. They were really wonderful things. We did a lot. And then there's the second part. Ma'me'od amku machshevotecha. Machshavot are thoughts. They're thoughts. And we are coming now into these 10 days of tshuva, these 10 days of return, repentance. This is the time of contemplation. Yeah? So we say, your thoughts have deepened. Your thoughts are so deep, O God. And for us too, our thoughts certainly did deepen, but as we go into this season, I invite all of us to transition from that mode of doing and to simply go into a mode of experiencing, thinking, contemplating. And the other meaning that machshavot has is design. Sometimes it's translated, how wonderful are your designs, O God. Designs is another good thought for us during this time of year when we get the wonderful opportunity to kind of think ahead in our year, to try and plan what did we not do so well with last year and how we're gonna start working on that. So I invite you to transition with me from the space of doing and clicking off everything from your to-do list and into the space of contemplation and being. Now, this is the space of tshuva, and this year, we have this incredible team of tshuva leaders. I can't tell you how well-supported I feel on this stage. Honestly, I feel like I'm with deep and powerful spiritual beings in all six of these people on this stage. The new shulers, you guys, I think, know Yonatan over there. This is Yonatan Gutfeld, the musical director. Yeah, you guys can do whatever, however you want to respond. And Dana Hertz, who also, yeah. Dana, who also led our prayers last year. And then over here, we got Frank London, right? You guys know Frank as well, right? And Frank is a deep spiritual being who calls out for all of us with his trumpet. Thanks for being here, Frank. So those are the figures that the new shul folks know well, and I wanted to introduce you also to these Beinenu people who have joined us. Not the Beinenu people over there or over there, but the Beinenu people over here. We have Yuval Leon here on the drums. And Saskia Lane on the bass. And Yuval and Saskia are going to give us what we need for this tshuva, which is some rhythm. Some rhythm. You can't do anything spiritual, really, without rhythm. So thank you guys for being here. And finally, I wanted to introduce you to Daphna Moore. And yes, Daphna is the co-spiritual leader of Beinenu and the musical director there. And she's a fabulous musician, but she also has this incredible power of prayer, which we'll be thinking about over these holidays. And I'm just beyond excited, Daphna, that you're here as our guest prayer leader. Daphna.
Thank you. Shana Tova. It's so good to be with everybody. We're going to start with a piyut, with a liturgical poem written in the 13th century in Spain. Oh, thank you, Jonathan. So if you can imagine, the time of like the golden age in Spain, and the Jews are sitting are in Spain, enjoying the plentiful that Spain has offered, but also yearning for the homeland. And this piyut is called Achot Ktana, and we're gonna sing it to Moroccan melody. This is new for everybody. And it is basically has this kind of repetitive, maybe, yeah, we're gonna see it. Repetitive line says, may this year and its troubles end. May this year and its troubles end. Tichle shana v'kilelotea. And at the end, there is this yearning for this new year and saying, may this year and its blessings begin. You'll see and you'll join us, but I want to offer it to you in as Misha was saying. I just want to offer you to just lay off all this, everything that you've been carrying to get to this year, to get to this moment. We're closing one year, we're starting a year, and just kind of think about the possibilities. Transition is always a possibility. And possibility for change, if it comes from outside, that we will be blessed, but also from the change that we can do inside in this new year. Achot Ktana. You have the melody, you have the heartbeat, you have your thoughts, your prayers. Achot Ktana.
Shine. exactly 225 years ago today, on Erev Rosh Hashanah, 1798. Hebrew year 5559, a boat from Istanbul arrived in the port city of Haifa in Palestine. On it was a man who was quite famous in that time in world Jewry. He was the great grandson of the Baal Shem Tov, the legendary founder of Hasidism. But when he came off the boat, nobody knew who he was, because he had given his disciples very clear instructions. Don't tell anybody I'm coming, and once I'm there, don't tell anybody who I am. He changed his clothes, and during the journey from Breslav, where he came from, all the way to Palestine, he exhibited some strange behaviors. He walked around barefoot in the streets of Istanbul, in the souk, and he kept kind of ditching his disciples and his followers and going to play games with street kids. When it was time for Shabbat prayers, he had a big meal. When it was time to eat the meal, when everybody came back from the synagogue, he went to the synagogue and prayed. Now, everybody knew about him, that he's this eclectic rabbi. They knew that he's not just this kind of regular guy, but that one of the amazing things he does is he tells crazy stories, surreal, psychedelic stories, the likes of which we might get to hear tonight. They also knew that he had an amazing dream world. He had this amazing dream world, and he would share this dream world with his followers, with his disciples. He would tell them his dreams. And the last thing that the people knew about him was that he would oscillate between tremendous ecstasy to these very, very low places where he couldn't even pray. Now, when Rabbi Nachman comes to Palestine in this trip, he's trying to do something kind of strange as well. He's trying to shed Rabbi Nachman. He's trying to get rid of who he is. That's why he changes his clothes. That's why nobody can know who he is. And he's shedding his identities and his behaviors. There's lots of stories about this pilgrimage, but there's one fact that kind of blows me away more than all the others, and that's this. It has to do with where he did not go during this pilgrimage. Imagine taking a pilgrimage trip to the land of your ancestors that you've been praying to, thinking about, telling stories about your entire life, and skipping Jerusalem. He spends all this time there, but he never goes there. He never goes to Jerusalem. He goes back to Breslav without going to Jerusalem. So why? I'll try and answer that by telling you about something that happened in that part of the world, not too far in Cairo, about 500 years before. 500 years earlier, there's another rabbi, it's always rabbis, called Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon, Maimonides, right? People know Maimonides? Yeah. So Maimonides wrote something called the Laws of Repentance. The Laws of Repentance. It's part of this big, massive book, important book of his called Mishneh Torah. And in it, he describes some things that people do to make tshuva. Yeah? He says the paths of tshuva, as he called them, they include things like brokenhearted prayer, giving to charity, separating oneself from the object of their transgression. But then it gets a little more interesting. Then he says this. People who make tshuva, what do? They change their name as if to say, I'm a different person, not the same one who sinned. They change their behavior in its entirety toward righteousness. Finally, he says this. They move into exile from their home. Exile, he says, atones because it causes a person to surrender to humility. When you go somewhere that you've never been before, right? You know that feeling? You come into some new place, you're more alert for how you're supposed to behave, and you're also more alert for what might be beautiful and what might be dangerous in that place, right? You become more present and more humble, which are these two key components of this thing we're here to work on called tshuva, humble and present. Rabbi Nachman was on a journey of tshuva, a journey of return, but he didn't go there to sink deeper into who he was, but he went there to find out new things about himself. He went there to play with the kids in the street. He went there to get out of his comfort zone. Yeah, he went there to play. He didn't need Jerusalem and all that symbolism, all that heavy stuff. You know, that would be like going home. And he needed not to go home. He needed to remain in exile, even as he returned to this land of his ancestors. Our theme this year is called improvisation. Anybody know the Hebrew word for improvisation? Anybody? You guys know. Il tu. Let's try saying il tu. Il tour is a word that comes from two words in Aramaic, al and atar. Al means on, and atar means place. So to improvise means to be in the place, on the spot, right? On the spot, we're improvising, yeah? When I asked Frank about improvisation, I said, we're doing this whole thing about improvisation. He said, do a listening exercise. It's about listening, yeah? But it's also about responding. And it's certainly not about showing everybody the identities and the stuff in your personality that has a name. It's about getting away from all of that. So, those of you who are new to the new shul don't know that every year I am tasked with offering the community a spiritual assignment, so to speak. Yes? That's why I'm telling you this whole story. Because this year, after a conversation with Amy and Adam, a year ago or so, where they told me about an assignment that Rabbi Zach gave a few years ago, I decided that something like that would be the right assignment for this year. So here's your assignment, okay? You'll get it on email too. But between now and Yom Kippur, you got 10 days to complete this assignment. What you're supposed to do is go somewhere you've never been. Yeah? Get on the subway and go and get off at some stop that you've never been on. Yeah, you've never walked out at, I don't know, Clinton, Washington. I don't know, you know, one of those stops. Oh, he has. Or take a walk out of your home or drive somewhere and walk around and take in the place, take in the smells, take in the flavors, and treat whatever happens there, whatever people you interact with, treat them as angels sent to guide you on this journey of tshuva, okay? Try and take some notes about what went down, because on Yom Kippur, we'll take a moment to talk together and hear about what happened when we went to I don't know where. And with that, sounds good, Daphne's into it. And with that, I ask you all to please rise for the Baruch Hu, the call to prayer.
Ya, 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 ya
Turn to the Shema Yisrael. There's no improvising without listening. Shema, hear, listen.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad.
On telling our kids, this is the birthday of the earth and the birth and creation. So we need to also bring the celebration also up a little bit. So Yuval. This is a melody to Malchenu Avinu. I've learned it actually through my child Arty there, right there. And I took the melody and put it into Kamocha. This is kind of Jewish for a lot of us, so it goes like this. Also loud.
Hashkivenu. Hashkivenu Adonai Eloheinu leshalom. Ve'amidenu malkeinu lechaim. Lay us down, Adonai, for rest, for peace, and rise us up, raise us up for life.
And guard us when we leave and when we come back, for life and for peace. And if you can imagine, have a sukkat shalom, a canopy of peace above us. I always imagine having the protection from above, imagining angels from our sides. We all need it sometimes close to us for protection and for peace. Ushmor tzetenu uvoenu. I believe it is about 5 pe'ah. If you're looking at the machzor, it's in the middle. Ushmor tzetenu.
It's page 22 in the machzor.
Ushmor tzetenu.
For the Amidah. You can find the Amidah on page 27 in the Machzor. Dana's going to lead us in the opening blessings. And then our tradition at the New Shul is that you could either read silently in the Machzor and go through the Amidah traditionally, or just take a moment for silent meditation. Amida.
Adonai sefatei tiftach ufia gitei latecha. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu ve'Elohei avoteinu ve'imoteinu Elohei Avraham, Elohei Yitzchak, Elohei Yaakov, Elohei Sara, Elohei Rivka, Elohei Rachel ve'Elohei Lea. Ha'el ha'gadol ha'gibor ve'hanora, El Elyon, Gomel chasadim tovim ve'kone hakol, ve'zocher chasdei avot ve'imahot, ומביא גאולה לבני בניהם, למען שמו באהבה. זכרנו לחיים, מלך חפץ בחיים, וכתבנו בספר החיים, למענך אלוהים חיים. מלך חוזר ומושיע ומגן, ברוך אתה אדוני, מגן אברהם בעזרת שרה. אתה גיבור לעולם אדוני, מחיה הכל אתה רב להושיע. מחלקל חיים בחסד, מחיה הכל ברחמים רבים, סומך נופלים ורופא חולים, ומתיר אסורים, ומקיים אמונתו לשני עפר, מרמוך בעל גבורות, ומדום אלך, מלך ממית ומחיה, ומצמיח ישועה. מי כמוך, אב רחמים, זוכר את צורה לחיים ברחמים. ונאמן אתה להחיות הכל. ברוך אתה אדוני מחיה הכל.
עושה שלום במרומה, הוא יעשה שלום עלינו ועל כל ישראל ועל כל יושבי תבל, ואימו, אימו, אמן. עושה שלום עלינו ולא
Sit down. I'm very excited this evening to share a story with you all that has been driving me crazy for several months and that my family has heard too many times, but that I felt so strongly about it that I wanted to bring it to you this holiday so that we can try and crack the nut of what the hell this story is about together. And I'm even more excited that I'm not going to be the one to tell the story. Part of the reason I'm excited is because Martin's going to tell the story. Martin Reckhouse over here, who is going to come up on the stage in just a minute on the Bima. Martin, dear friend, director, actor, teacher, he's going to tell you the story written by Rabbi Nachman. And there's only a couple things that I want you to know about this story before you hear it, because it can be a little bit of a strange and confusing story. And that is that Rabbi Nachman wrote this story at a moment in his life. He was already in his 30s. He died young. He died at 37. But in his 30s, there was a moment in his personal life that made him feel like speaking to other people in normal language, giving a sermon or a dvar or any of those things, is ineffective. It doesn't do what things are supposed to do. It doesn't, in his language, it doesn't wake them up. It doesn't do it. A different language is needed. A language of stories. That's about it. That's all I want you to know. Okay, and with that, I'm very excited to invite Martin Reckhouse. And I just want to say one thing, which is that Martin's mother is in the hospital in Germany now, and her name is Anna Lich. And Martin would like to dedicate this story to his mother. Bakasha, Martin. Yeah, you can clap.
Once God, I call him her, the boss, said to himself, is there anybody around who's less worried than me? I've the best sense of everything. I'm the ruler and the boss. So he left and went to the streets at night. And he came to the first house. And inside the house, he heard a man wail. Ah, my business! It's good, it's bad, it's never too good. It's never bad enough. And they all want more and more and more. Even the 2-year-old children come up with their hands asking for more. So he continued. Then he came to another house. And in this house, she said, he left me. He just went. I'm kind of glad, but I don't know what to think anymore. Was it because of me? It's probably because of me. Or was it because of him? I really want to want an audience with the boss to find out what's going on here. And then we went to another house. Mm-hmm. And in this house, there were two women holding each other in their arms, and they both said, I only see darkness. When I wake up in the middle of the night and I want to turn off the light, I'll turn on the light. Still then, I see only darkness. We left this house. Mm-hmm. And then he came to a little house where the roof was closed. The windows were so low that they just reached just above the ground. He walked a little closer. And when he walked a little closer to the house, the window was half open. He listened. He listened really hard. And he listened even harder. And suddenly, he heard the violin play very, very softly. And then he looked through the window and saw a friend sitting on the table with a big jug of wine, a nice plate of food in front of him, and a big smile on his face. So he knocked at the door. The friend got up, opened the door, and said, hello, come in, l'chaim. And he gave him a glass of wine. And the friend drank, and the boss drank too, out of love. And then they both went to sleep. Next morning, they got up together, they wash. And he says to the friend, listen, friend, how you managed to be so happy and content? He says, oh, I have everything I need. Glass of wine, something to eat. To eat is to eat. I was never able to construct any things, but I know how to fix things. So every day I go out to the people, something's broken, I come over and say, hey, let me fix that. And I fix it. And that gives me my sixth room. And for the day. They parted ways. And the boss degree, nobody.
The degree from the boss. Nobody's allowed to give anything to fix to somebody. You gotta fix it yourself.
So he came around. Hey, got something to fix today? No? What's the matter? The boss agreed that you have to fix things yourself now. What? He walked a few paces and said, oh my God, talking about that, what am I going to do now? Ah, I trust in Adonai. And he saw a man chopping wood, a rich man, because he was chopping wood in a suit, a tie. Missed it again. So he said, hey, fella, you, such a wealthy, fine man, why are you chopping your own wood? Says, yeah, I'm chopping my own wood because I can't get anybody, you know. The refugees don't get a work permit, you know. Well, what if I chop your wood? You give me two builders, I do it. Well, it's a deal. So chop the wood. And it was finished, he went to another guy who was also chopping wood. So he chopped the wood. You can't hear me? Oh, okay. So he chopped the wood. And after he chopped wood three times, he had his sixth gilded. He went home, a meal is a meal. He bought some food and some wine. And he said in this house, And the boss came by again. He stopped in front of the house, listened. They had a glass of wine, they went to bed. Next morning they got up. Before they parted way, the boss said to him, "Listen, my friend, how were you doing yesterday?" He said, "Oh, yesterday was a difficult day, you know, I fixed things, but yesterday there was a decree by the boss that nothing could be fixed anymore by anybody but yourself, so I chopped wood." "All right, have a good day, have a good day." Guess what happened? The boss decreed everybody has to chop their own wood. So he walked around, "Hey, wood, no, wood, no." Then he saw a lady who was cleaning the barn. Oh my God, she looked so unhappy. Oh, she hated that, no love for the broom at all, you know? And she's so going on. He says, "My sweet lady, why are you cleaning the barn? I can do that for you. Give me two gulden, I do it." "Okay, done, you got his gulden." He cleaned another barn. And another barn, a meal is a meal. He went home, coming to the door. He listened. He knocked on the door. L'chaim. They sat down and drank. It's fact, he got up in the morning. He says, "Hey, how was your day yesterday? Because I've been asking that forever, you know. Can I ask you one more time?" "Oh, no, no, the rest of it was kind of okay, you know. It started hard, but nobody was allowed to let anybody chop wood. But then, you know, I found cleaning the barn worked really good, you know. So I'll see you later, you know, see you later. Baruch Hashem." So a decree came. And the decree said, everybody has to chop their own, clean their own barn, and chop their own wood, and fix their own things. So he comes and wants to do it, nothing to be done. Says, "Okay, I have only one thing left. I will join the army." So he goes to the general. He says, "General, I'm here, ready. I know there's two ways to do it. You can either sign up for life, or maybe we have mercenaries. You know, I sign up for a little bit. Don't let me do it too long. The only thing I demand is, can I get paid every day?" General said, "My man, welcome to the army." So they give him a uniform, you know. The jacket is too short, the pants are too long, the hat is funny, and then they have a big saber. Says, "Yes, sir! Go get to work. Yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir, all day." And then he goes to the general and says, "Can I have my pay?" General says, "Yes, you know, 6 gulden. Good, a meal is a meal." He goes home, eats his food. Guess what happens? Yes, the boss comes. He looks through the window. L'chaim. Next morning he gets up. And the boss calls the general. He says, "General, listen, you have a very quick story. Today is an exception. I don't want to have to explain you why. It's infinite wisdom, but no soldier is going to get paid today, okay? Their pay is going to be paid tomorrow. You got that?" "Got that, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. Okay." So he does his soldiering all day, you know? And then he comes to the general and says, "General, please, I'm ready for my pay, you know?" And he said, "I'm sorry, my man, you know, you've been a good soldier, you know, been standing around a day doing nothing, but you get paid tomorrow." He said, "Well, you told me I'm getting paid every day." "I'm sorry, nothing I can do, I get paid tomorrow." So he thinks, these were the last hard days, no? Trust in Adonai. And he thinks, since I can fix everything, let me take this metal off the spade, go to the pawn shop, get 6 gulden, and replace this by wood and paint it. So he does that, put it in, and he goes home. A meal is a meal, they'll knock at the door. His little song. The next morning,
They both wake up. And the boss says to him, "So, how did you get your splendid meal and your wine yesterday?" He said, "Yeah, well, I wasn't paid, so I pawned my sword, and then when I think today I get paid for 2 days, I pawn it out again because I can fix everything, but the boss will never notice." And he goes on his way. So the king calls every chairman of the board. And calls them earlier and says, "Listen, there's a guy. I'm going to call him in. You have to fetch him. And get me somebody who's condemned to death. And tell him he has to come and cut his head off." "If you say so, boss." So they go get him. He comes. And the boss says to him, "Listen, my friend, here's your task. You're a soldier. This man here over there I'm going to bring is condemned to death. Justifiably so. But you have to cut off the head." So he falls in front of the boss's feet. He looks up and says, "Oh, please, dear boss, I have never shed a blood of anybody in my life. You sure this guy's really guilty? That there's not a little bit of doubt?" Says, "My friend, I'm telling you, this guy is really found guilty. Everything is in order." And then, when the fellow saw that it was impossible to influence the boss, he turned to Adonai and said, "Adonai, I have never shed somebody's blood in my life. If this man is not liable to be put to death, my blade should turn from metal into wood." And he takes the sword out, lifts it up in the air, and everybody starts laughing. And the boss looks at him, says, "I knew you were a fine guy. Live your life in peace."
Toda rabba, Martin. Toda rabba. So that's the story that Rabbi Nachman wrote. And we're going to take a minute to try and figure out something about it. So, good luck. So here's the first thing I'd like to say, and that's that actors are types of magicians. Actors, they perform magic. There's actually nothing quite like it. They create a world out of our imagination, right? Through the power of this imagination, their own, and then the imagination of everybody in the room, right? So today on Rosh Hashanah we say, Hayom Harat Olam. Hayom Harat Olam. Which means, today the world was conceived. Today the world was conceived. And so Martin just conceived a world for us and created it. And the amazing thing about this world that Martin created is that he created it with a sword that was made out of wood. It was a fake sword, right? We know there wasn't really that world with the boss and all these things, right? But this fake sword has real implications in our life because an actor creates real emotions inside of us that then lead us to act in certain ways in the world. And then the world changes, right? So the world kind of functions on these wooden swords. There's one thing that I need you all to know about symbolism in Rabbi Nachman's stories. And that, I think you got the first one, which is that the boss or the king, he calls him, Rabbi Nachman calls him the king. Martin wanted to change it to the boss. But the king is God, right, as Martin laid out. And the other is the sword. The sword in Rabbi Nachman, based on Talmudic sources, is prayer. Take that in for a second, that the sword is prayer. So, in this story, we're in this symbolic world of our spiritual existence, and at the heart of this picture of our spiritual world is this character called the Fixer. The Fixer. And that Fixer is us. We are the Fixer. Wynton Marsalis once said, "We're jazz musicians. We make it work." That's what fixing means. Yeah, that's what fixing means. It's improvisation in the face of a problem, right? He keeps having these problems, and then he keeps improvising some kind of solution, right? This is what we're talking about this year. How can we take the problems in our lives and improvise through them rather than be subsumed into the dust with them, which is what I do sometimes. If you imagine your life as though it were a piece of music, and you're just one of the instruments in this piece of music, then it's possible that if you are, for example, stuck in a subway car between two stops, it's possible that you won't feel so oppressed by that situation, right? You might not feel like you're being wronged in some way, right? You might, instead of a frown, you might offer a note or a frill. That's that mode of listening and giving back that I spoke about with Frank before. So Rabbi Nachman, I think, is suggesting that we try and live that way. We try and live our lives in this way of improvisation. That's what we're working on this year. And that offers us a kind of lightness that we can walk through the world with. Yeah. But as we know about lightness, it doesn't always hold, and we'll inevitably lose that sense of lightness that we did so well to carry for so long, we're so proud of ourselves, we'll end up on our knees in front of the king or the boss or maybe in front of the mirror, right? And in that moment, we'll know that we're busted. We'll know that we're holding a sword that's made out of wood. It doesn't work, and we can't fix it. Unless we come up with a truly fabulous joke, like happened in that story. That's our one way out. If we can admit that the things we take most seriously in our lives, including in this moment tonight, including our prayer world, our spiritual world, our Jewishness, our identity, if we can admit that whole thing, this whole Jewish thing, this whole spiritual thing, all of that is in some way made of wood, then we might have a chance of our prayers actually working. This is what Rabbi Nachman is saying. If we can admit that we are playing, even as we commit fully, just like an actor does, to whatever we're doing, if we can admit that we're playing, then our prayers might work. Rabbi Abby Stein, who joins us this year as scholar in residence, grew up, Rabbi Abby grew up in the Hasidic world in Williamsburg. She carries a deep understanding of the place of play in the Hasidic spiritual system. And not only that, but she's also been forced to improvise a life for herself that led her out of that world to create a new life as a trans rabbi and author. She also told me that one of her earliest rebellions as a teenager was, guess what? Reading Rabbi Nachman's stories. Early rebellions. Rabbi Abby is uniquely situated to help us understand this story and figure out what this message that it's trying to give us is. I'm honored and thrilled to invite Rabbi Abby Stein to say a few words.
Let me start by saying that all I can do is attempt or try to understand stories because, frankly, we're never really going to understand it, but that's the point. Let me get personal for a minute, and then if any of you stick with us for 10 days and you come back for Eli, we'll get personal for 20 minutes. But now we're going to get personal for just 1 minute. I left the community I grew up in, and my family, and I should say, this whole Rabbi Nachman thing is, to me, a bit, it's very personal, not just because of my community, but also, I happen also to be a descendant of the Baal Shem Tov, the founder of the movement, and through something that I would describe as nothing else than family dispute that has somehow turned spiritual, my family to this day carries an extreme animosity towards Rabbi Nachman and towards everything Breslov, to the extent that one of the worst things I could do as a teenager was reading some of those stories. But after I left my community, I had a 2-year period where I hated everything Jewish. My idea of Yom Kippur the year after I left was a camping trip where everything, like every part of a pig I could possibly put on a menu was on the menu of that camping trip on Yom Kippur. But a year later, I went for the first time to a synagogue that was a horrible place, as far as my parents were concerned, with mixed seating and a woman rabbi and live music on Yom Kippur. That's, sorry, if, in case any of you don't know, that's horrible. All of these things are just horrible. Not in my book, but... And then my dad told me about my prayers. I felt, for the first time in my life, I actually truly enjoyed and loved everything about Yom Kippur, everything about the holidays. And my dad told me, I would rather you go back to the desert, you go back to the forest, to the camping trip. He didn't say go back and eat pork, but that's basically what he said. Rather than go and pray and be at a place where he thinks it's the wrong way of doing it, it's the wrong way of improvising. Why am I saying this? Rabbi Misha mentioned that this story specifically was written after Rabbi Nachman's son died. Rabbi Nachman in general had a very hard life. Mostly in family, but also generally he was kind of a very rebellious figure within a movement that was at the time still considered very rebellious. I know if you look at Hasidic people today, you're like, wow, rebellious. But that is what the movement originally was. It was a very rebellious movement. But he was considered rebellious even kind of like even worse. And his son's dad, but among a lot of other things, he kind of at some point in his life switched from his original book, which is not that far off from a lot of other classical Hasidic texts, to those stories, for example. But one of the other things, and something that I remember reading as a child as one of the really bad things that he did, is a concept in Aramaic of milin letzad ila'a yemalel. He was talking words against God. He reached a point in his life, which I think we're basically seeing in this story, where he said, F you, God. Literally, like you look at this story and the king or the boss does not come off as nice or good. And when you think of this as being God, you go, okay, so God is horrible. And Rabbi Nachman, which I will say, along with a lot of other Hasidic masters, was very comfortable with that. But I want to think a second about the sword. We mentioned that a sword refers to prayer. Wood, already in the Torah, already in the Tanakh, ki ha'adam etz hasada. A person is wood. Wood is the essence of life. A wooden sword is something that is dedicated to killing people, made out of something that is life at its core. Which is amazing for Rabbi Nachman and amazing for so many of us. I'm talking for myself, but I think many of you might agree, where it's like this innate contradiction. I don't want to talk for anyone, but if I have to go on a guess, I'm going to assume that I'm not the only one who's standing here on a Friday night, on Shabbat, on Rosh Hashanah, with a microphone surrounded by music, but people, my way of celebrating Rosh Hashanah, my way of celebrating the high holidays is different than the ones my grandparents or great-grandparents did. And correct me if I'm wrong, but I think for a lot of us, we might have that similar feeling. But whether it is something that from your own childhood, from what other people are telling us, we very often are being told there are way of prayer, there are way of practicing. Or in this case, the king is saying that your way of doing things, I don't like it, I'm going to try to do whatever I can to stop you. Or my dad being, go to the forest and eat pork, just don't go to a synagogue that isn't Orthodox. Very often people take a metal sword, a sword made out that kills, and that is their prayer. Their prayer might be, oh, it's beautiful and it's great if you follow, if you do it the correct way, if you do it the way prayers are meant to be done, if you do Rosh Hashanah, if you do holidays, if you worship God in the correct way and believing the correct way. And then so many of us want to go and be like, I don't like this. I want to improvise. I want to do this in a different way. And to me, this story is telling that this wooden sword wasn't just okay, because imagine for a second if that person shows up there and he didn't do that. He shows up there with his original sword. What ends up happening is he would kill people, because he would have been forced to kill that man if he actually had the traditional way of sword. Far too often, the traditional way of doing things could end up killing people, whether as an individual or as communities, when we insist or refuse to improvise, refuse to work with the reality that we have and to bring in the life. As we enter the high holidays, and I feel like it's going to be nice, at least for me, to come back during the Neilah and kind of see how we have all felt about all of this for the next 10 days. But going into this, I want us to think of what it means to look at tradition, to look at our own experiences, as our experiences of a community, and create something new, and to know that that isn't just, okay, fine, you did it. Our recognition that this isn't, I hate the word truth, I feel like it doesn't do it as much as emet. It doesn't have the same meaning, at least to me. Even if we look and we're like, this isn't the accurate, this isn't the correct way, this isn't the traditional way, this isn't how my parents have done it, this isn't how I did it last year, this doesn't feel real because of what I did the past year, this doesn't feel real for whichever reason, the recognition that it's all a lie is the most honest thing that we can do. The recognition that it is a sword made out of wood that is useless is the most powerful sword that we can ever hold up. And together, we create something beautiful, intentionally beautiful. Shabbat shalom. Shana tova. Or if I want to say, if anyone understands what I'm saying, let me know. Git Shabbos, git Yom Tov, and git Geben Shtiur.
Toda. Rabba, toda Rab Abi.
This is our new nigun for this holiday.
Mourner's Kaddish is on page 44. I invite you to please rise. And I invite you to bring into the space anyone you're missing, anyone who passed during this time of year, anybody who passed during this last year, any ancestry you wish were here, or you invite into the space. Please speak the words with me. Yidgadal veitkadash shemei rabba be'alma divra chirutei ve'yamlich malchutei בחייכון וביוחייכון וביום חיי לכל בית ישראל בעגלה ובזמן קריב ואמרו אמן יהי שמי רבה מבורך לעולם ולעולמי עלמיה יתברך וישתבח ויתפאר ויתרומם ויתנסה ויתהדר ויתעלה ויתהלל שמי דקודשה בריך הוא לעילה לעילה מן כל ברכתה ושירתה תושבחתה ונחמתה, דאמירן בעלמה ואמרו אמן. יהי שלמה רבה מן שמיה וחיים עלינו ועל כל ישראל ואמרו אמן. עושה שלום במרומיה, היא תעשה שלום עלינו ועל כל ישראל ועל כל יושבי תבל ואמרו אמן. Thank you, please be seated. I'm very grateful to a lot of people who helped make these high holidays, everybody on the VOD and Judy and all the people who've helped this evening and who will help throughout the holidays, and probably above all to Susan Myers, our executive director. I'd like to invite Susan to say a few words.
Tova. It is such a pleasure to welcome all of you this evening. This is my fifth High Holy Days as the executive director of the New Shul. My fifth welcome speech on this special night of Erev Rosh Hashanah, the beginning of the new year. For the previous 4 years, I have begun by speaking about the past year at the New Shul, and I have always said that if I had to describe the New Shul in one word, I would say community. Tonight, I'd like to begin a little bit differently with something that is intensely personal. Early last fall, my mother-in-law passed away following a long and difficult illness. 2 weeks later, my mother passed away unexpectedly. Fast forward. Early this spring, I faced a health challenge that I am surprised and delighted to say has made me stronger and healthier than I have perhaps ever been. In May, I watched my second son be conferred with his doctoral degree. And just 2 weeks ago, my oldest son announced his engagement to Mary. A bitter, dark fall and winter, followed by a light and joyous spring and summer. It was my personal journey, but also a communal one. With my deepest gratitude to so many in this room, I was never alone. L'dor v'dor for my family, Kehila Kadosha for all of you. Our community is a creator of sacred space. Without a building, we're nomadic Jews who carve out sacred space wherever we go. We're a community center. Holiday celebrations, the teen ice cream club, living room Shabbats. Again, spaces that we create, imbue with spirituality and meaning for everyone. We are a Beit Midrash, a study center. Rabbi Misha and the extraordinary minds and spirits of his rabbinic Havara, delving into Torah text and listening to thought-provoking speakers, a rich tapestry of learning for everyone. I work as a Jewish communal professional. I used to have a sign over my desk that read, "We are sustaining the Jewish community." It sounded so relevant at the time, but now I see that it's limiting. We can't rely on sustaining. That would mean that things stay the same, safely held in place, no moving forward, no moving back. This status quo isn't good enough for us. We need now to dream of next steps. So what are our next steps? Step one, partnership. It is such a pleasure welcoming all of you from B'nai'nu. When Misha first told me about the possibility of partnering with your incredible community, I went to your website, and these words rang so true for me. B'nai'nu means between us. Between us, we create holy space. Between us, we forge lasting relationships. Between us, we are everyone. What a perfect alignment. What potential for next steps. These High Holy Days are just the beginning of powerful, relevant, musically exquisite joint programming between our communities. For the past 3 years, we have been growing our partnership with the School for Creative Judaism, and we are now ready to take another step in this incredibly important journey. There's some back office integration that I won't bore you with, but I can assure you it will lead to growth for both communities. Together, we will discover new ways to question and celebrate our intergenerational impact on who we are as Jews, Jewish families, and a combined and thereby strengthened Jewish community. Step two, Shabbat. It is a joy to announce that this year we will be holding a Shabbat program every week. Once a month, there will be in-person gatherings with music, reflection, and renewal. Most months, there will be a living room Shabbat, dinners in the homes of community members. And once or twice a month, there will be virtual Shabbats led by various leaders. Shabbat is an opportunity to recapture tradition while bringing serenity and joy to our lives. For many, it is also a time to unplug. It has been scientifically proven that eating with family and friends is good for our health. Spending Shabbat in the embrace of our new shul family on a weekly basis will expand who we are in ways that are almost impossible to articulate. Step three, tikkun olam, to strive for justice. Jewish values guide our actions and deeds. This coming year, there will be bi-monthly community service days designed to deepen the impact of all that we do. The Kuma Festival, holiday programming, and Chevrutot that continue our deep investigation of contemporary issues through the study of ancient texts. All moments for lessons that we will apply with our collective boots on the ground. Stay tuned, there's lots of details to come. But in the meantime, I ask you to personally resolve to take action. Share our community with your friends and family. Invite somebody to a community Shabbat. Open your home for a living room Shabbat. Join a Chevrutot. Let us grow together, not just in numbers, but in connections to each other. Let us measure our success by the value you place on the new shul in your life, in the warmth we feel among our TNS family, in the fun we had at Summit's house celebrating Shabbat, turning things upside down at Purim, or simply learning something new in the closeness of our personal and communal ruach. Last fall, I needed the new shul to support me through my dark time, and our community was there for me. Last spring, I needed the new shul to share my joy, and our community was there for me. I knew in those essential personal moments that the value I place on the new shul is beyond professional. It is essential to my well-being as an individual. I knew the limitless value that words cannot even begin to describe of our kahila, our community. This new year, let us freshly commit to each other that the kahila of the new shul has value and meaning, and that we are better together than we are apart. Lashana Tova from my family to yours.
You want to invite Mia?
Yeah. I want to invite Mia, one of our magical teens of Beinenu, who agreed to sing Shalom Aleichem with us for Shabbat. Please join.
Shalom Aleichem, Malachi Ashame, Malachi
Koach Mia, toda rabba. I would like to invite Rabbi Abby, who really wanted to do the Kiddush. And I thought, I said, I really want you to do the Kiddush. So wait a minute, we have some wine. And while it's wine over there in the corner, yeah. Dana, you want to grab the wine? And while we're getting this ready, oh, we got it? We got what we need?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll do my best not to take too long. Yom ha-shishi v'yechilo ha-shamayim v'yaretz v'chol tzevam v'yichal Elohim v'yom ha-shvi'i melachto asher asa v'yishbot v'yom ha-shvi'i mekol melachto asher asa V'yibarech Elohim et yom ha-shvi'i v'yikadesh oto ki bo shavat mikol melachto asher bara Elohim lasot tzavri Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam borei peri agafen Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam Asher bachar banu im kalam v'romemanu im kol lashon v'kidashtanu b'mitzvotav V'titen lanu Adonai Eloheinu bi'ahava et yom ha-shabbat hazeh v'et yom ha-zikaron hazeh yom zichron teruah bi'ahava mikra kodesh zecher litziat mitzrayim כי הבנו בחרת ואותנו קידשת עם כל העם ודבר חיימת וקיים לת ברוך אתה אדוני מלך על כל הארץ מקדש השבת ויום הזיכרון
Abby, I'd like to invite a few people, Diane and Rabbi Sasson, and their grandchildren, Ezzy and Manu, if they're here. No, oh, they're gone, okay, without their grandchildren. Diane and Rabbi Sasson, and Deborah and Artie and Alo for some blessings. We're gonna start. These are my parents-in-law, and they're here from Montreal. And I'm very happy you guys are here. You're very happy to be here. They come from the Mizrahi tradition, and they've been teaching me all these Mizrahi blessings every Rosh Hashanah. There's about 100 of them, and most of them are about enemies and things like that. But and they each come with a corresponding food. So we found one food. Where are the dates actually? Okay, we're bringing the dates. There are dates. Bevakasha.
יהי רצון מלפניך, אדוני אלוהינו ואלוהי אבותינו, שיתאמו חטאים מן הארץ ורשעים עוד אינם. ברוך, ברכי נפשי את אדוני. הללויה.
הללויה.
May it be your will, Adonai our God, and God of our ancestors, that wrongdoing pass from the earth and the agents of cruelty disappear while the righteous grow tall like a date palm. My soul, bless Adonai. Hallelujah.
It's actually worse than that, but that's okay.
You guys have to bless.
Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam borei peri haetz.
יהי רצון מפלנך, אדוני אלוהינו ואלוהי אבותינו ואמותינו, שתחדש עלינו שנה טובה ומתוקה.
Amen. May this year bring sweetness and happiness, health and peace to all of us. Shana Tova. Shana Tova Umetuka. Toda Rabba. See you tomorrow morning at 11 at the park. Chag Sameach.